Broadcast tonight, history. Cate Blanchett, who plays Queen Elizabeth I.
Particularly with a role like Elizabeth, I just immersed myself. I read a lot of, obviously, a lot of biographies about her, but it was the discussions, I think, that, and the various opinions that came out of the conversations of, about her and about the legacy that she left England, and really how she culturally transformed England as we know it.
And Ian Kershaw, who writes about Adolf Hitler.
He wasn't so supremely gifted in other ways other than a sort of instinct for power, I think, and the way he had a profound instinct for the weakness of his enemies and the weakness of his adversaries, and would always go for the jugular because he understood where the weakness was.
Blanchett and Kershaw, when we continue.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
It's my pleasure tonight to be the one who gets to announced the nominees for Best Performance by an Actress in a Motion Picture Drama, and they are Cate Blanchett, Elizabeth. Be good. Fernanda Montenegro, Central Station. Susan Sarandon, Stepmom. You can be mine anytime you want, Susan. And the wonderful Meryl Streep, One True Thing. Emily Watson for Hillary and Jackie. And the winner is, God, if it's a tie, I'm lost. Ooh, Cate Blanchett.
Joining me now, Cate Blanchett. Before I introduce you, you had not seen that.
No. That was genuine shock.
You didn't expect it?
No, not at all. No. You don't. You sort of, you do the work and then that stuff is sort of, I mean, it's fairyland, really. Yeah. So, but it was wonderful.
After critically acclaimed roles for Cate Blanchett in films like Paradise Road and Oscar and Lucinda, she has become one of our finest actresses and a favorite for this year's Oscars. As the star of the film Elizabeth, she portrays the title character, Queen Elizabeth I. In 1558, at the age of 25, she took the throne of a Catholic country, declared a Protestant, fought off assassination attempts from the French and the Spanish, and ruled for more than 45 years. Here is the trailer from the film.
Princess Elizabeth!
I am commanded to take you hence from this place to the Tower. You are accused of conspiring against her sovereign majesty.
Tonight I think I die.
For the love of God, will you leave your kingdom to a heretic?
The Queen is dead! Long live the Queen!
There are moments of crisis.
You have inherited a most parlous and degenerate state. It's threatened from abroad by the ambitions of France and Spain and is weaker than I have ever known it.
When absolute power...
A court to worship you, a country to obey you. I will mean nothing to you.
How would you know you're everything?
Is held by none.
Until you marry and produce an heir, you will find no security.
And coveted by all.
How dare you come into my presence? Why do you follow me here?
It is my business to protect your majesty. Norfolk's power in court is growing. It is said that he and his foreign allies are raising an army that will outnumber your own.
I am my father's daughter. I am not afraid of anything.
Your Majesty would improve all these matters if you would agree to marry.
But marry who, Your Grace? For some say France and others Spain. So I'm not sure how best to please you unless I married one of each.
What is hers by right of birth?
You must reassure His Majesty that the time is close at hand.
You are in the greatest danger.
Must be defended.
Today I shall watch the fall of that heretic god.
But old loyalties.
You must take these things so much to heart that you do not fear to strike.
And youthful passions.
You are still my Elizabeth.
Oh, I am not your Elizabeth. I am no man's Elizabeth.
Must give way.
I will have one mistress here and no master.
To the duty of a queen.
And let it all be done.
Again, I am pleased to have Cate Blanchett on this program to talk about an extraordinary film, an extraordinary role, and an extraordinary performance. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Tell me how you thought about this role and how you approached it and what you wanted to make out of it.
Well, the things that I've always enjoyed playing most in theater and in film as well, they've been parts and stories that I have had no idea how to approach at all. They sort of, I think that as an actor I can often confuse anxiety with excitement. And so I think because of that excitement, I and particularly with a role like Elizabeth, I just immersed myself. I read a lot of, obviously a lot of biographies about her, but it was the discussions, I think, that and the various opinions that came out of conversations of about her and about the legacy that she left England and really how she culturally transformed England as we know it. And what I was curious that listening to all the cast, the English cast, that they had such differing facts, and they kept saying, well, this is backed up by historical fact, and I thought, that's amazing. So I tried to sort of embrace all those disparate opinions about her and galvanize them. And I think that in a lot of ways, that's what Elizabeth is actually doing in that she's galvanizing the opinions that her enemies have about her and using them against them. So
that's in part of how you came to see her. Mm. Tell me more about, you know, once you immersed yourself in this, you had a script, but as you immersed yourself into this extraordinary woman, to use extraordinary one time too many, what did you find and what was interesting to you about her? And what did you say, if nothing else, I want to get this about Elizabeth?
Well, Shekhar Kapoor, the director, from the very beginning, he was talking about her as an unformed being. And from all the letters that I read about her, and certainly all the people that the ambassadors, foreign ambassadors who came and met with her, right from not only before, it was before she was queen, it seemed to go against that. And so I couldn't understand what he was talking about. She seemed to be so self-aware, and she had really strong performance instincts, I think, because right from an early age she had to wear a mask in order to survive. She had to, I suppose, mask her religious differences to Mary, her sister, because Elizabeth, I guess, was more aligned with the Protestants, and Mary was obviously a Catholic. So I found, I suppose, that to inhabit that naive young girl in a very knowing way, and in a lot of ways, I suppose, I held my cards as an actor close to my chest whilst trying to inhabit the mask that Shekhar was interested in, if that makes
sense. No, it makes a lot of sense. Yeah. What about her shaped her in coming to give her the strength that she had to survive and to rule for so long?
Well, I do think, and this is something that Shekhar did talk about a lot, and being Indian, I think it sort of gave him a different sort of sensibility on it. He kept talking about destiny, and I think that Elizabeth had a very strong sense of destiny. And so I think that, and she's desperately ambitious, incredibly ambitious, and probably had a lot more natural ability as a leader than her brother and Mary, her sister, had.
She was deadly ambitious.
Yeah. So I think the thing that moved me most about her was her isolation, and how she had basically, by the time she was 9 or 10, there had been rebellions in her name, and people had most of the people, her mother was obviously beheaded by her father, which, you know, obviously dislocates you from your family.
Anne Boleyn and Henry VIII.
Yeah, so I think it was that she was a still point in an incredibly turning world, and that she had to look after herself. And I think because really the film does deal with, it's a love story in a lot of ways, I found it interesting that she did hold herself back. She didn't ever completely give herself over to a great love because of her enormous political ambition. So I think it was probably that isolation.
Well, you and I were talking earlier, and I said there was something about if you have great opportunity at governance, you know, and it is your mission and your mandate and your destiny, in a sense, that becomes what your life is really about. And as you said, she just gave over herself to that in lieu of sex and a lot of other things, as far as we know.
Mm.
Yes,
and
in terms of a traditional family life, unlike Queen Elizabeth II.
Yeah, or the monarchy at the moment. I think it was obviously a much more God-centered universe than we exist in now. And the divine right of being, the divine chain of being with God at the head and the serfs down the bottom, the monarch was actually anointed by God, and therefore to go against the king or queen was to go against the church. And, I mean, something that does interest me, and also in terms of what's happening to Clinton at the moment, is that sense of morality that almost overtakes all political decisions. That somehow there's a universal sense of morality, and I think that Elizabeth was saying that her propriety and her own personal sense of morality was shouldn't be under question because she was anointed by God. It's quite confusing. And
I get the point, though, but. The interesting thing about her, too, is that I suspect that for a young actress, there are few roles that are more interesting to undertake because the life is so full of largeness.
It's so dense and so rich. I mean, it's a gift of a role for an actor, and particularly this journey in this particular fantasy of Elizabeth, in that the bookends of the film are so extreme. So the arc of the journey that you get to map out as an actor that is really rare, the journey that she goes on. A lot of roles, actually, you shift from A to A and a half, you know, A plus. You don't actually get to go to
it's
Z.
It's incremental.
So, I mean, that was really important to me. And because we were working in quite a chaotic way, and there were a lot of... Everyone knew what the essence, the spirit of the story would be, but we didn't know how it would piece together. Obviously, I mean, so rarely you do in film. But it was important to me that those changes were, like you're saying, incremental, that they were subtle, that it wasn't sort of all of a sudden she was turning into the monarch as we know her.
What happens between a director who you did not know, who'd seen you in Lucinda, as Lucinda, I guess in the movie or in a promo or something.
In a promo reel, I think.
In a promo reel, Meaning what, somebody had given him a series of reels and this was one of the people he might look at, or was it just a promo reel for Oscar and Lucinda?
I think it would just happen to be floating around the office, working title
and
office.
And he said, take a look at this. And he looked at it and knew that you were the person he wanted.
Yeah, he very romantically says that he saw my face come out of the water and he knew it was me, but, a screen test and a lot of discussions later. But I mean, that's great. I mean, it's when I met Shaker, it was more, I think my relationship with him was more characterized by silences. And I think it's a very deep, profound way to work when someone knows when to come in and when to go out. And he was very sensitive about that stuff. And he cast very specifically, and I think quite eclectically. Like sitting around the table, you had, Lord Attenborough, and then you had Eric Cantona, and then you had Vincent Cassell, and then you had Geoffrey Rush and myself, and all from quite different acting traditions, and he was somehow able to galvanize all those people.
Quite different acting interpretations of Attenborough, of course, lives in London. Quite different interpretations of Elizabeth, or all of you united by the script that you had in terms of what you wanted to say about her?
I think... we were united in the fact that we'd come together every morning and thresh out something, and we'd sort of block something out, but still we wouldn't know exactly what it was. So I think in a lot of ways, a lot of myself included, a lot of the actors were kind of shifted off center. And there's such a sense, I think, in my vast career, you know, but that you have to be in control as an actor, and that if you don't know absolutely what's going to happen, then you can't actually mark the journey. And what I sort of discovered is that it's a really great way to work in that chaotic environment, because you can often reach for things and not quite get them, and it's often in the grasping for something that a magical moment is produced. You don't have to get there. Do you know what I mean?
I do. Here's another clip. I want to show a lot of this because it's such
a
great film. No. I know you said that when we sat down. Here's another interesting thing. Jeffrey Rush is he Australian or
yep.
New Zealand?
Australian.
Shine, we know him from well.
Mm-hmm.
You are Australian,
mm-hmm.
and the director is
Indian.
Former parts of
the... yes, all the colonies are represented.
Here is after the death of Queen Mary, Elizabeth becomes the queen.
My lady, the Earl of Sussex is here.
The Queen is dead. Long live the Queen. Long live the Queen.
This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
You shot this at the same time as you were telling me as we were watching this. Mm. Princess Diana had just tragically been killed.
Yes.
And so there was a sense of transition and mourning.
It was the strangest thing. We were, I was in London and actually got the call from Australia that she had died. And then the very next day we went up to Newcastle to film that. And I'd never been in a stranger environment. There was a sort of this pall over the whole cast and crew. It somehow had to be in the with 150 people who were all ostensibly mourning, even though they didn't know this woman. It was quite strange, and it just gave a weird sort of tilt to this scene. It was very strange, because prior to that, I mean, she'd had as much impact on me as women's magazines, and it was really quite humbling.
You, when you finished this, had you changed your perception of her at all? Or, I mean, had anything, just the sheer doing of it and all the labor that went into it, did it change anything about your feeling for her?
I suppose it
deepened it or something?
It deepened my sense of her humanity. One of the very first things that I did, just before the British Library closed for relocation, I went in and had a look at some of her letters. It was Essex death warrant, I think, and then there was a letter to her her brother when she was incarcerated, asking for her to be released, so that she would have been 17 and then she would have been maybe 60. And to see her handwriting, I'd only known her as this powerful monarch who had left such a stamp on England, and I suddenly saw her as a living, breathing human. And I think it's invigorating to then go back and read about her, because it somehow draws you and implicates you in when you're reading a dry history book,
yeah,
I suppose.
So. It does. One more look at this. This is the clip from when Sir Francis, the great friend of Elizabeth, played by Jeffrey Rush, tells her that he is there to protect her because it is not believed that she is fit to rule.
I regret to inform Your Majesty of our miserable defeat in Scotland. bishops to demand Your Majesty's removal and find support in every quarter. Alas, madam, we are come already to contest.
How dare you come into my presence? Why do you follow me here?
It is my business to protect Your Majesty against all things.
I do not need protection. I need to be left alone.
Majesty.
They should never have been sent to Scotland. My father would not have made such a mistake. I have been proved unfit to rule. Well, that is what you all think. Is it not, Walsingham?
It is not for me to judge you.
Why did they send such children? Why did they not send proper reinforcements?
Because the bishops would not let them. They spoke against it in the pulpits.
Then they are speaking against their queen.
Madam, the bishops are against you and have no fear of you. They do not expect you to survive.
I think of you sitting around the table, and there's the director, and there's Sir Richard Attenborough, Dicky to his friends.
I never know what to call him.
Yes, Sir Dicky. He's a presence there for you and someone that you admire. And
He was a rock. And incredibly humble, obviously, because he's a director as well, but he completely supported Shaker and all of us. But on the very first day of rehearsals, he was sitting beside me, having that terrifying moment of the read-through, which is just, particularly when you're doing an accent, and particularly when you're playing the Queen of England, you get a bit nervous. Yeah. And I looked over, and he had his folder there, which Noel Coward had given to him. And in the back, in Boston Gold, were all the films that he'd been involved in. And I just sort of was looking across, and I thought, my God, they're the great films of cinema history. Yeah, so he's a living legend, but he's so generous, and I found him so nuanced as a performer, and also so clear, and he's able to give over his preconceptions and expectations to what Shaker was wanting to do with the film.
The first thing you notice when you see these clips, if you haven't seen the film, is how much movement there is with the camera. The camera is someone circling her wherever she goes, wherever you go.
Yeah, it was an interesting thing that Shaker said, and really helpful when we started shooting, that he wanted the camera in the beginning to be a predator, and then as the film progressed, that it would become a loyal subject. So amongst all the chaos of the filming, I always knew what the audience was. So it gave me a really strong sense of, a strong sense of audience. Yeah. So at least that was a clear
So it goes from all around you to, in a sense, being at your feet.
Mm. And much more still. There's a lot more. I mean, I've only seen the film once, but a lot. Right. The camera. There wasn't as much movement or tracking or up and down. You know, the early days were like, oh, it was really sort of difficult to navigate. But that was the emotional experience of it.
You've only seen the film once.
Oh, well, what's the point? I've had the experience. You've got to give it over to the audience. But maybe I might watch it again on video. It's important, I think, for me anyway, to watch it. You know, particularly because I haven't made that many films. Yeah. To learn what worked and what didn't work, but in the end you can drive yourself crazy with that sort of stuff. You just have to realize what the experience was at the time and go ahead and hopefully not make those same mistakes again. Or
there is about you this sense that early on people were saying you had it, whatever it was, talent, let's say. Did they say that?
My mother said that.
Well, of course, mothers always say that. But even others who said they watched you early on when you were in drama school.
I mean,
did you feel that? I mean, that this man, whatever else there is about living, I have found what I came here to do. You were a natural for this. I mean, whatever it was that once you began in drama school, people began to take notice, and it just worked for you. I mean, you're not Emily Watson we just saw in The Globe. She was rejected three or four times from drama school before she got.
And I'm sure in hindsight she says it's you know, character building, but at the time it's incredibly traumatic. And I think that actors are a product of their experience as actors, and part of, I think it's a growing sense of security I suppose what I was trying to say is that straight out of drama school I was working with Geoffrey Rush, you know, yeah. Who's a god of the theatre, you know, who's Lecoq trained, and he's astonishing to work with, like just amazing. And so to have that experience and then to be cast alongside Rafe and to be working with Frances McDormand in Paradise Road, you know, they're the votes of confidence where you think, well, maybe something's working. But I do just think job to job. Every time I start a role,
but each part adds. Go ahead.
Every role, I think I don't know how to do this. I don't think I can do this, and so it means that you have to approach it with a sense of humility and really try and unlock something, not come over the top of
but
something.
Is there something different between humility and insecurity?
I think there is.
Humility is I have to have a certain respect for. So that I will give it my best, as if it's my last role ever.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's the more you do, the more you can look back and say, that worked, that didn't work, and therefore you can sort of briefly pat yourself on the back. But I don't like to dwell on the positives of the. I like to sort of close the door in a lot of ways.
When you leave it, you leave it.
Yeah, so I can move on afresh, I suppose.
What's the ambivalence about?
Well, in that I suppose, you know, way back when I was at high school, I was interested in watching and participating from the outside. So I guess that's the way I sort of tend to approach work. And I don't know.
You're more observer than actor, in a sense, in your own mind?
Maybe naturally.
Yeah.
And I think it's that thing where every time you go into a rehearsal room, the hardest thing is saying, okay, I have to get up and embarrass myself, and I have to embrace that right to fall flat on my face.
Could you also argue, though, that being an observer means that you constantly, if you're an observer, are watching qualities, watching characteristics, watching what it is that makes a character a role, or
then,
you know, that you can mimic, that you can pick up on, that you can incorporate.
No, I like when I'm out to dinner with someone, or I'm reading a book. I like to just be out to dinner or reading a book,
yeah.
And I think that's the thing. It's and which is tricky as an actor is you have to keep one technical eye out, but then you have to be completely inside the experience, and that's the way I like to live my life, is completely inside it. And I guess that's why I don't think so far ahead.
So when you were doing Elizabeth, you thought like Elizabeth, you moved like Elizabeth.
I'm not a method actor. I sort of think that you've got to use whatever is around you. And I think a lot about filmmaking, the piecemeal nature of it can be frustrating, in that you don't have that luxury of going through the arc of the night as you do in theatre. So you kind of have to use those circumstances to your advantage. Like if you've got a cold, you've got to use it. I mean, you know what I mean? Like I don't.
Yeah. You leave this performance in Elizabeth to go to the stage in London in a David Hare play.
Another thing I don't know how I'm going to approach, but I'm really excited. I was speaking to David. Plenty is
right.
The play, and it hasn't had a production inside London since it was first performed in 1978. And he was saying it would be interesting for the younger generation, he's calling me the younger generation, to perform the play, and also a younger audience to see it who haven't got that visceral experience or that recent memory of the Suez Canal, because for him it's a quite a political play,
yeah.
Whereas I read it and got straight into the emotional and intellectual side of it, you know, because I think just beginning to read about the Suez, it was a door through which the British populace went through, from which they didn't return. You know, it was a failure, and I think that sense of failure and the impact that it has on post-war Britain.
I remember when I was in college, I was.
You remember the Suez? That's okay.
I do remember the Suez. I wasn't in college then, but I remember it. And I remember when I was in college, I had an assignment once to go back and read all of the editorials of the New York Times on the crisis. You know,
mm-hmm.
And to try to see an editorial position of the Times on the Suez as we saw it unfold. you know, as a crisis. I mean, you remember people that, you know, look like foreign secretaries, like Anthony Eden. Mm-hmm. People like that, you know, look like foreign secretaries ought to look like in one's imagination. You're wonderful, and I thank you for coming, and congratulations on the Golden Globe, and much success with the Oscar and with Plenty on the stage. When does it open, Plenty?
About April 26th, I think.
So you have time.
I have time.
Australia remains home?
Yeah. There's a famous song about it, but I won't sing it.
Oh, please. Come on, tell me just a little.
And Peter, you know Peter Allen song?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
That I still call Australia home? Well, it is.
Thank you. Back in a moment. Stay with us. One of the names discussed as the most controversial of the 20th century, one man who appears on every list when you talk about the people that have influenced and had an impact on the century, is Adolf Hitler. There have been volumes written about him and the devastation he enforced, but the question of how one man could come to personify the face of evil remains elusive to historians. One of the most preeminent scholars of Nazi Germany is Ian Kershaw, a professor of modern history at the University of Sheffield in England. He has spent the last 10 years working on a two-volume biography of Adolf Hitler. The first volume is called Hitler, 1889-1936, Hubris. I am pleased to have Ian Kershaw here to talk about a book that is being lauded by many as the best Hitler biography in a number of years. I'm pleased to have him, as I say, on this broadcast. Welcome.
Thank you.
Why is it that we are so curious about Hitler?
I think it's right to say the fascination with Hitler remains intact after all these years, and greater than the fascination with other monsters of the 20th century, greater than that with Stalin, for example, who arguably had more people killed than Hitler did. But Hitler has shows us what we're human beings are capable of, and shows us the darkest side of civilization. Shows us also how thin civilization is, what can happen. And Hitler has claimed to be the main author of the most destructive war in human history, claimed to be the main author of the most terrible genocide yet experienced. Those are two very good reasons why we should continue to be preoccupied with this figure who's cast such a stamp on the 20th century.
But is it more than that that draws us to Hitler?
Well, there is...
Was it the nature of the man, the nature of the, you know, the flair for the dramatic, all of that?
It's all these things put together, but even so, when all's said and done, it's what can be done with the massive power that he was able to wield, and how such an unlikely figure could ever come to wield it, which, unlike, as I can compare Stalin and Hitler yet again for a second, Stalin, I think, if I simplify a little bit here, we see as the last in a line of Russian tyrants. Doesn't surprise us in a way. Stalin's background is that of an apparatchik in the Communist Party. He takes over, rules with tremendous brutality. Hitler comes from nowhere in a highly modern, highly civilized state, a land of culture, the land, it's a cliche to say, but the land of Beethoven and Goethe and so on. And out of this, wields a power which is unconstrained, and which then takes within this highly sophisticated modern state, within a small number of years then, into war and into this terrible genocide.
What does the word hubris, how does it inform us about who he was in his youth?
Hubris is a word that means overweening arrogance or pride, and obviously the comeuppance for that is their nemesis, which is the title of Volume 2. The goddess Nemesis comes and takes revenge for pride, and in a sense, therefore, that is a fitting two-part approach to looking at Hitler. But I think what we can see in his early years, perhaps there are three characteristics of Hitler that really do stand out. Will, absolutely extraordinary will. Fantasy, the will that goes with these grandiose fantasies, from architecture to dispatching armies and human beings around, sending them to their deaths and so on, and outright brutality. And these three things, certainly two of them, the will and the fantasy, we can see in the early years. The brutality we can only get glimmers of, and that really comes through only when he comes onto the political scene, or we can see it only when he emerges on the political scene after the First World War.
Take us through his life before the First World War, which had a searing impact on him.
Yeah. It was a life after a fairly nondescript period in his early years, from a very unusual family background, however, with his father being married three times. The third marriage to Hitler's mother was near incestuous in the proximity of the two families. They were very contrasting figures, a very domineering father, the mother making up for this in mollycoddling him, almost suffocating him with love. He was the first child to survive out of four of this marriage, so again probably the mother poured extra attention on Adolf. Once his father had died, his mother gave him the run of the house. He was an idler. From that point on, from his adolescent onwards, his schooling went downhill. He stayed in bed late in the mornings, doodled and drew and wasted his time essentially. Spent the evenings going to see operas. Living in this fantasy world which he saw in the Wagnerian operas that he so much admired. Then he went to Vienna, hoping to go into the Academy of Fine Arts. He was so certain that he would go into this, because his one ambition was to become a great artist, and the world would have been saved a lot if he'd been even a mediocre artist who'd didn't enter politics. But he wanted to get into the Vienna School of Fine Arts. He was turned down. It was actually no disgrace. A lot of more people were turned down than succeeded. But for him, that was an enormous shock. His mother died around about the same time, and this twin shock certainly was had a searing impact on him in that time when in Vienna his money then ran out soon afterwards. He then sank right down into the gutter, and his resentment started to boil up against the world which had somehow rejected him. From that, it was a drifting experience living in a men's home in Vienna. He, as a draft dodger from the Austrian army, he made his way to Munich in 1913, still with his sort of fairly aimless existence, selling his little picture postcards of tourist spots around the beer halls and cafes of Munich. And what saved him, or appeared to save him, was the outbreak of the First World War. Absolute elation at the outbreak of the war, in company with many others. Famous picture shows him in the crowd, being joyful in 1914. And the war for the next 4 years meant everything to him. The regiment, he said, was his home. And at the end of the war, the defeat and the revolution was the major shaking point, I think, which then turned Hitler, the drifter, into Hitler, the obsessive politician consumed with hate.
When did he acquire the skills of a demagogue?
They came to him quite rapidly, but suddenly. He wasn't aware that he had any of these skills before 1919. In the men's home in Vienna, and then in the First World War amongst his comrades, he'd been regarded a bit as a bit of an eccentric, bit of a loner, and nobody had really listened to his tirades when he gave them. Suddenly, in 1919, after the war, the climate had changed. And when he started talking then, he was still in the army at this time, he was commissioned then to go and he went on some courses, anti-Bolshevik courses. Then he was sent in to indoctrinate the troops who were about to be demobilized, to immunize them against communism, socialism, to train them, indoctrinate them in nationalist ideas, including anti-Bolshevik and anti-Semitism and so on. He went on this course, and then he came back as the star turn on these courses. And all the reports back from the Soviets said how terrific he was as a speaker. And Hitler said in Mein Kampf a number of years later, in two separate passages, "All at once I realized I could speak." In other words, people started listening to him. And his superiors took notice of this and started then to think, well, here we've got somebody who is a born rabble-rouser, born demagogue. Soon after that, he joined the infant Nazi party. And within a very short time, he was the star turn in this Nazi party. People were flocking into the beer halls of Munich to listen to him, above all, because he was able, more than anybody else, to speak the language that ordinary people understood, ordinary people who were already in some way in sympathy with his ideas.
Was he writing these speeches himself?
Yes, he wrote them himself. His speeches at this time were jotted notes, scribbled notes. He didn't speak from a script, but he spoke from jotted notes. And the speeches, even as you see the construction of them, they're rambling speeches. They're not like a modern politician's speeches, full of well-planned sound bites and so on. But Hitler was a soundbite man just the same. He knew when to reach the crescendo and so on. This was a matter initially of instinct to him. And in the raucous atmosphere of these beer halls, it doesn't matter really so much how well coordinated the ideas are. What matters is the emotion and the fire with which you can express the hatreds and resentments and the hopes and aspirations that people were feeling at that time.
When did he begin to make these associations with people like Goebbels and the rest of them that became part of his coterie?
They came into the scene at different stages. Goebbels came from North Germany, and he had joined a similar sort of grouping who were attracted to these ideas, but he actually came into contact with Hitler really only in 1925, so some years later when Hitler was already well established. Goering, much earlier than that, in the early 1920s, Ernst Röhm, later on the leader of the stormtroopers, who was Hitler had him killed in 1934 in the Night of the Long Knives, he was a key figure right at the beginning in helping to smooth the links between Hitler and the army, and he was known as the Machine Gun King of Munich, and was able to get arms for the paramilitaries there. So that was a very important early contact with Hitler, also smoothing the path to some of the leading figures in the Bavarian establishment.
He went to prison and wrote Mein Kampf in what year?
Yes, he wrote the first part of Mein Kampf while he was in prison in 1924, and the second part he finished off when he came out of prison in 1925.
Where did the anti-Semitism come from?
Anti-Semitism was very extensive and commonplace throughout much of Europe at this period, and quite especially was prominent in Vienna, in the Vienna that Hitler experienced, in the circumstances we've already talked about at the beginning of the century. And Vienna was one of the most anti-Semitic cities in Europe. Hitler picked up this vitriolic hatred of Jews there. And then later, during the First World War, where people were now scouting around for scapegoats to find to explain why things were going so wrong, the hatred of the Jews welled up again within Germany in 1916 to 1918. Hitler experienced this at first hand when he went back to on leave to Berlin and especially to Munich, and he was himself looking for explanations as to why his world had crumbled beneath his feet, why what he'd invested in, what he'd seen as a future then had collapsed. And he found his explanation then in the figure of the Jews. It was an abstract hatred for him, I think, above all. I don't think it was personalized. I don't think you can find any single example in his life where he had a really bad experience at the hands of a Jew or something and focused on that. There have been attempts to demonstrate that, but they're not convincing.
Grandfather wasn't Jewish either, as you demonstrate.
His grandfather wasn't Jewish, and his contacts, for example, with the Jewish doctor who treated his mother, who died a painful death in 1906, this Jewish doctor he thought highly of and gave him presents, and later on in 1938
no personal experience that we know of that,
really
that caused him to
experience.
Have
That's
such
why,
a
yeah so this personal this abstraction but in 1918 and finding this that he could focus his hatred for what was going on upon this group who he accused at the one and same time as being the war profiteers and also the group who were fomenting unrest at home, which was stabbing the German war effort in the back, stabbing the troops in the back, bringing about this revolution in 1918, which for him was absolute anathema, and bringing about Germany's defeat. And Hitler's career really can be seen in large measure as an attempt to reverse the defeat and revolution of November 1918.
How smart was he?
Quite smart.
How do you know?
Quick. Well, for example, I mean, in terms of the way he had an extraordinary memory for one thing, for factual detail, he was able to master the brief of quite complicated material that came before the cabinet on finance matters and so on. He wasn't stupid by any means. Foreign secretaries who came to Germany who met him attested later on to the way in which he could understand the complexities of a discussion and speak then without any notes on these difficult issues, had mastered it. So in all these ways, it would be crass to really just regard him as some people did at the time in their patronizing way as just some rabble-rouser, had no talent beyond that. But of course he wasn't supremely gifted in other ways other than a sort of instinct for power, I think, and the way he had a profound instinct for the weakness of his enemies and the weakness of his adversaries, and would always go for the jugular because he understood where the weakness was. So in all these ways, I mean, it's not a matter of intellectual excellence, of course, it's a matter of sharpness of mind, quickness, very quick in his spoken words, in the way he formulated things, again, not only in the beer halls, but in one-to-one discussions, he could formulate matters always in this black-white way, which meant that a one-to-one discussion was very, very difficult, not to say impossible, to win with him, because he had such a rounded view where one part of the argument would support the other, and this quickness of it, and along with a domineering personality, meant that it was as good as impossible to overcome that in a one-to-one confrontation.
What myths have you uncovered about him? I mean, what is it that you think you didn't know that you now understand because of this massive study?
Well, I think what we have to do is to unpick the way in which he himself presented his development. And once you do that, then the myths start to fall away, and you see a gradual development even of some such things as the hatred of the Jews, as which we've been discussing. But above all, you see how, and I think this is the strongest point which I was trying to get across, that this was not a triumph of the will. That is the way in which it was depicted by himself and by his Nazi followers. This was not a triumph of the will. He could have been stopped on innumerable occasions, but also the image of Hitler that we have is a construct, it's a product, which was a product of circumstances in Germany, above all in the early 1920s, where people started to attach to Hitler these heroic qualities, which at that time he didn't attach to himself. So far from it being a notion of a planned, staged assault on power, it was actually handed to him also at different stages along the way.
He took advantage of chaos.
He took advantage of, he was an opportunist par excellence, as well as being an obsessive ideologue and a superb propagandist.
What did Goebbels' diaries, which you found in Russia, which were discovered in Russia?
Yeah, I didn't find
them. I changed the way. What did Goebbels' diaries tell you about Hitler's character, personality, demeanor?
I think one thing which they do show, along, they confirm, of course, many of the things which we've been talking about here, about the refusal to bend to instances where he's faced with a crisis. But one of the things which comes out in the Goebbels diaries very strongly, which you don't tend necessarily to think about Hitler, is his hesitation, that he wavers. He's not this all-decisive Führer who immediately leaps in and takes the big, brave decision, but he's somebody who havers and wavers and hesitates and doesn't know at times which way he should go. And Goebbels is intensely irritated by this wavering on many occasions. And that's a strong element of Hitler's character, which somewhat surprised me in this, the extent to which on so many occasions he hesitates and doesn't really seem to know which way to go. Then all at once he acts, and when he acts, it's usually when he's pushed into a position from which, in his own thinking, it's either or, everything's either or, and now the or is closed off, so there's only one way to go. Then he acts, and only at that point, and with the utmost, but then at that point, with the utmost brutality, with staggering brutality and ruthlessness. And I think that's a pattern that we see throughout these Goebbels diaries, from the early crises in the Nazi Party in the mid-1920s, right through into the major problems of the wartime period, as calamity upon calamity piles on Germany. And I think one other point on that, which I perhaps just add, is the extraordinary way that also, in certain ways, surprised me, I think, the extraordinary capacity that this man had to turn a negative into a positive, to see some really positive development out of something which normal people would regard as absolutely a lost cause. But I'm particularly thinking now about military developments during the war.
Have any military skills? Other than instinct?
Yes, he did. It was there were a lot of instinctive reactions which came off. But for example, in 1940, the brilliant German maneuver which encircled the French armies and the British armies effectively won the war in France within a matter of weeks. It was not directly his idea, but he was unhappy with the ideas that the generals were putting forward. He was toying with this idea, and then he heard that General Manstein had put forward a plan which was similar to his own, got Manstein and asked him about it and said, that's it, that's what we need to do. The other generals were opposed to it, he pushed it through, and it was, of course, an extraordinary military triumph. So there was there something which was beyond just instinct. There was some military skill. The military skill, however, was linked to taking the initiative, seizing, holding onto the initiative, to aggression. He was lost after the end of 41, or certainly by the end of 42, once the Germans had surrendered the initiative completely, once it was a defensive war, and then his tactical skills were, of course, hopeless. And in that position then, fighting a rearguard action, he was still depending solely and almost entirely by the end on this notion of will, that will will be triumphant. And of course, in military terms, that's at that point then is just the road to catastrophe.
Shot himself in when he was what, 54, 55?
56 it would have 56. Been, 88, 89, yeah, 56. He looked about 75 by then.
You want to write, you spent 10 years of your life, two volumes. Second volume, I assume, is near completion?
Almost complete, yeah. Not too far off.
From the beginning, you wanted to do Hitler rather than all the other historical figures because you were, you were interested in Germany, interested in that particular period of world history, or what?
Yes, well, it's not really a dramatic shift for me because I've been working on the Nazi era quite intensely and very often in Germany for 20 odd years now. I started working on German society initially. I moved on looking on reactions to anti-Semitism and to Nazism, Hitler's popular image, moved on from there to the structures of the regime, and from there then to the figure who was the central figure in this regime. So in a sense it's been a fairly logical and inexorable step for me, but it is also because I do happen to think a point we're making at the beginning, that Hitler is one of the central figures in the 20th century, if not the central figure, in terms of his influence, regrettably such a terrible influence, and to that extent therefore that at the end of this century it is still important to do the utmost that we can to understand this phenomenon, not just Hitler the person, but what he was able to do in Germany, why a society, and that was my starting point, why a society allow it to happen and could find appeal in this person.
And what was your answer?
My answer was that if you actually start from the premise that democracy is not the best form of government, although we tend to think it is, and that's our starting point, but in the 1920s and 30s it wasn't. There you had a situation of national humiliation, lost war, economic bankruptcy, failed democracy. The feelings that Hitler was able to articulate here were feelings that were shared by very many people, not of course the personalized parts of his horrific vision. But for a long time in the 1930s, it could seem to ordinary Germans as if this really was a most a wonderful leader who'd rescued Germany from chaos, put things straight, given the country its pride back, put it back on its feet, and so on and so forth. And that explains why the links between what the aspirations of so many people on the nationalist right were in Germany at the time and how they overlapped with Hitler allows us to see, I think, quite clearly how these people could find all sorts of common ground until the common ground gradually started to diverge and they realized that they'd opened up Pandora's box.
The notion is that if things are going well for you and the economy is improving, full employment and everybody has sees good times ahead than they're that's willing right. to overlook.
Yeah, that's it.
Both real danger yeah. and potential disaster.
Yeah, that's it.
Thank you for coming. The book is called Hitler, 1889-1936, Hubris, Ian Kershaw. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, all about Michael Jordan, our guide is David Halberstam, who spent the last year writing a book about MJ called Playing for Keeps. Join us.